All right, so we are going to continue with the analysis of implementations of DSP algorithms now. So yesterday what we saw was how do we find a theoretical bound, the iteration period bound, that can be used as an estimate for what is the best possible iteration period that can theoretically be achieved for a given signal processing system, right? So once again, keep in mind, even though I say theoretically possible, it is subject to two constraints. One is that you are using this particular data flow graph in order to implement the DSP system, right? So the connections that you have made as far as the data flow graph are concerned are assumed to be sensible or accurate, right? So if you have made some mistakes while drawing the data flow graph, that would in turn impact the throughput that you can theoretically achieve. The second one is it's also obviously dependent on the technology that you are going to consider. So in other words, by moving to a smaller or faster technology, you automatically can get improvements in the iteration period that have nothing to do with the signal processing algorithm being implemented. Now, what we are going to do is, okay, now let's leave aside the ideal situation. Let's move on to practical considerations. What happens if I actually am trying to implement a filter in hardware? Okay. So right now, most of our considerations are still in the domain of how do I implement something in hardware. But as you probably have sort of understood by now from the analysis that we have done, the data flow graph concept by itself doesn't necessarily restrict itself to hardware, right? If I have software implementations where each actor in the data flow graph is a function that takes a certain number of clock cycles, the same analysis that I have done so far would hold true over there as well, okay? All right. So anyway, for now, let's look at the problem of implementing a FIR filter, okay, with the equation yn equals a x of n plus b x n minus 1 plus c x n minus 2. Okay, the straightforward hardware implementation for this looks something like this. I'm going to draw block diagrams from now onwards, not the data flow graphs. They are interchangeable. I hope there is no confusion introduced in terms of how to visualize them at any given point in time. If there is any problem, please feel free to stop me and get it clarified. So the simple block diagram would look something like this. We have x of n being put through a shift register to generate x of n minus 1 and x of n minus 2. Each of those elements goes through a corresponding multiplier applied to adders, and the output y of n. Okay. As we discussed earlier, the critical path in this particular implementation corresponds to this red line that I have marked over here, right? So that the critical path length is essentially given by the time for one multiplication plus two additions. Okay, so keep in mind, when I write something of this sort, I am making certain assumptions. For example, I am ignoring things like the setup time of the individual flip-flops and so on. I am also assuming that there are flip-flops or registers at the very input. So x of n, in other words, is coming from a register, and y of n is going into another register. Okay, those are sort of the implicit assumptions that I'm making over here that I'm not really going to elaborate on. If you have a finite setup time, a finite clock to queue delay associated with the registers, then those will also add to your critical path, right? But they are just sort of, I mean, those are just implementation details, so I'm going to skip those. Primarily, the critical path is dominated by these factors, the multiplier time and the two adders that are in series. Okay, so for example, if I have, let's say Tm is equal to 2 nanoseconds, Ta is equal to 1 nanoseconds, these are just arbitrary numbers that I'm pulling out, right? I mean, they are not real values for any given technology. It's just an example that we are using over here. The sort of one thing you can generally speaking assume safely is that a multiplication takes longer than an addition, okay, simply because it's a more complex operation, more complicated operation. But having said that, on modern processors, for example, this may not even be true, right? Both multiplications and additions are capable of being performed within a single clock cycle. And as long as your resolution, time resolution, is limited by clock cycles, it basically means that multiplication and addition are going to take the same amount of time. So again, like I said, it depends on the underlying technology. In this case, with this assumption, what we are saying is that the time period, the clock period that I use, must be greater than or equal to 4 nanoseconds. Right, this is the clock period that I can use on these registers. That in turn implies that the sample period is greater than or equal to 4 nanoseconds, because in this particular implementation, the sample period and the clock period are exactly the same. So the question now becomes, how do I improve upon this, right? And more importantly, are there certain things I can assume in terms of what is the best possible throughput, or how do I compute the best possible throughput for an architecture like this? Okay. So one simple way, you remember where we came up with the idea of the iteration period bound. Essentially what we said was, look, I can implement the entire thing. If I have enough hardware, in other words, I can implement multiple copies of this hardware and get better throughput. Okay. So let's look at what something like that would look like. One way by which I could do something of this sort is, I do precisely that. I basically create two copies of the hardware. So I have x of n feeding in here, and let's say I have x of n minus 1 feeding in here. Okay. Now what this architecture effectively means is x of n minus 1 is also being computed over here, or rather being produced over here, and x of n minus 2 is being produced over here. At this point it is x of n minus 2 and x of n minus 3. Okay. The multipliers, coefficients ABC, ABC remain the same, the adders structure remains the same, right? The assumption is, at a given point in time, okay, I am basically going to apply x of n to the top filter, x of n minus 1 to the top filter, okay? I will get correspondingly y of n as the output, y of n minus 1 as the output over here, okay? At the next time instant, okay, I will assume that I am essentially going to shift through two steps of the shift registers, so that after this, the next one that goes in over here is x of n plus 2 and x of n plus 1. Okay, but in order for these intermediate values to be generated correctly, it means that I'll effectively have to shift two values through the register. So I have to sort of assume that there is one shift register where I can pump through two values through it quickly. Okay. So in other words, x of n, there will also be one x of n plus 1 that comes over here, x of n plus 3 over here, and so on. And similarly, x of n is over here, x of n plus 2 is over here, so that the corresponding values can then be skipped through into this. In other words, x of n will be here. On the next clock cycle, x of n will go here, and the x of So I have x of n minus 1, x of n minus 2. In the next time instant, I will have x of n over here, I'll have x of n plus 1 over here, and x of n plus 2 over here. Okay, so that this will then compute y of n plus 2, right? And similarly, the first time around I have x of n minus 1, n minus 2, n minus 3. The next time around, I'll have x of n minus 1 jumping over here, x of n over here, and x of n plus 1 over here. Okay? Right? So, in other words, the assumption is that the way that the shift registers are implemented is I am able to sort of skip forward two steps. Okay, but that's just an implementation detail in terms of how the shift registers themselves are implemented. All that it means is the sort of forward connections that need to be made between them. It need not necessarily pass through both the registers. It can directly skip ahead and go forward two steps. Okay, why is this important? Because we want to make sure that the top filter is always computing only the even values of y, and the bottom filter is computing only the odd values. I do not want the top filter, in other words, to compute the odd values and throw them away. That would be a waste of computational power, right? So I essentially assume that I can skip forward by two steps so that the top filter can just concentrate on computing even valued y outputs, okay? And the bottom filter correspondingly can then compute the odd valued y outputs, okay? So effectively what happens in this situation is, once again, the T clock, which is basically the critical path, remains exactly the same as before, 4 nanoseconds, right? But every 4 nanoseconds, two outputs are produced. Okay, and that effectively tells us that our sample period becomes half the clock period. Okay, the average sample period can become half the clock period simply because we have thrown twice the amount of hardware at it. Okay, there's nothing really very fancy about this. All that I'm saying is I'm throwing twice the amount of hardware at the problem. It is possible to arrange the data in such a way that the computation can actually be done at twice the throughput. Okay, in order to understand this a bit more clearly, you probably want to contrast this with the case of the IIR filter, right? I'll leave that as an exercise for you to go through. Try and see if you can do something similar for the case of the IIR filter, and you will find that you cannot because of that dependency, right? After all, that was a dependency that led us in the first place to this concept of iteration period bound, and you will find that in this particular case that prevents you from using twice the amount of hardware effectively, okay? But in the case of the FIR filter, you can do that. You can put in twice as many adders and multipliers and actually feed the data to them alternately such that the overall throughput doubles. Okay, so the throughput is number of samples being processed per unit time. Okay, and that ultimately is the most important goal of a signal processing system. Okay, how many samples can I process per unit time? Okay, not really the clock period at which I am operating. That is incidental. Even if I can operate at a low clock period, but I can process many samples per unit time, that is perfectly fine as long as the number of samples being processed per unit time meets whatever sampling rate that I require. All right, so parallelism, in other words, is a fairly simple way of improving the throughput, which applies in the case of these kind of especially the FIR filter type of structure, right? There is one additional twist to this that I'll just mention before we move on to another approach that can be used to improve throughput, which is slightly more interesting in general. Okay, the twist that we can observe as far as parallelism is concerned is, if you go back and look at this diagram over here, you'll notice that, for example, this x of n minus 1 is occurring in two places, right? Similarly, x of n minus 2 is occurring in two places, right? And I'm effectively having to put two registers over there and generate those data, right, separately. What if I try and sort of combine that, right? What it would look like is something like this. So what this means is I have now separated out the x of n, which was coming in over here. I'll call it x of k over here, and basically say that I can split it up into two streams. Okay, the even numbered values of x go up, the odd numbered values of x go down. Okay, and the clock that is given to the corresponding registers has a time period of 2t rather than t. Okay, and what that means is, what are the outputs of these registers going to look like? If x of 2n is being fed to the top register, what was it that appeared one clock cycle earlier at the output, at the input of it, and therefore is currently going to appear at the output of that register? X of 2 into n minus 1, or x of 2n minus 2. Okay, so what you're going to see over here is x of 2n minus 2, not 2n minus 1, because only even numbered values are going here. Okay, so the way to think about it is x0, x2, x4, x6 are the values that are going in here, and x1, x3, x5, x7, odd numbered values are going to the bottom stream. So if x0 is appearing at one place, or rather x2 is appearing at one place, the previous value that came there was x0, and that is the one that's going to be at the output of this. X1, in other words, never makes an appearance on the top at all. Similarly, x0 or x2 never make an appearance on the bottom stream at all. Okay, and with this, what we can do is, now I just have these two registers, okay, and I can write down two new equations which basically say y of 2n equals a times x of 2n plus b x of 2n minus 1 plus c x of 2n minus 2, and y of 2n minus 1 equals a x of 2n minus 1 plus b x of 2n minus 2 plus c x of 2n minus 3. Okay, now how do I get these values? All that I need to do is observe that if the input on the lower register was x of 2n minus 1, its output is x of 2n minus 3. Therefore, I have all the values that I need. Multiply this by a, this by b, this by c, okay, and add them up. I'm just drawing one adder over here for simplicity. In reality, you'll need a chain of two adders, and this basically generates y of 2n. Okay, and similarly take this one this one this one y of 2n minus 1. Okay, so what has happened? The amount of hardware that I use in terms of the number of multipliers and number of adders remains the same. Nothing has changed over there. Okay, but if you observe this a little carefully, what you will see is that everything from this point onwards from the point that you have made this split, right, everything to the left of it has a clock period of t, and everything to the right of it has a clock period of 2t. Okay, the registers are basically operating with a clock period of 2 times t. Okay, why is this important? Because if you actually try doing a timing analysis on the right hand side of this circuit that I've shown over here, what it means is that all your static timing analysis, your critical path computations and so on are now trying to meet a timing goal of 2t rather than t. It's much more relaxed. It's easier for it to meet that timing constraint. Okay, you can use, if necessary, you can even use slower multipliers and adders. Okay, and by using that, whatever is on the right hand side finally will come down to operating at a slower speed. Now, how do I fix this? What I need is, at the opposite end, once I have done all of this computation, I need to take these two streams and combine them back into a single output, right? Which will basically give me y of n. And what that means is that over here, once again, the t clock is equal to t. On the left hand side over here, t clock was equal to 2t. Okay, so this entire area in the middle, in other words, right, is operating at half the frequency of the actual input. Okay, now this is potentially a very good thing, because one thing, in general, if you need to operate something at a lower frequency, it is easier to do. Why? Because you don't need to worry too much about optimizing your hardware to a very great extent, right? You might be able to get by with smaller transistors with lower drive strengths that are still able to meet the longer clock period requirement that you have. Okay, and the other thing that you can do potentially is, you know, this is one part where you need some familiarity with digital IC design. What is the connection between the operating voltage and the time, the propagation delay through a circuit? In general, if I increase the operating voltage, keeping the technology otherwise the same, would I expect to see an increase or decrease in propagation delay? I should see a decrease, right? In other words, the circuit can switch faster, right? So in other words, for a given technology, right, let's say it's a 45 nanometer technology, if I operate my transistors, if the supply voltage that I give is increased, it means that the transistors can now deliver a larger amount of current, they can charge the output transistors, output capacitors faster, and therefore the propagation delay will decrease. Conversely, if I reduce the supply voltage, I will end up increasing the propagation delay. Okay, now as far as this particular structure is concerned, what it tells me is I'm allowed to increase the propagation delay, which means that I may be able to get away by operating at a lower clock frequency. Okay, and this brings us into one slight side topic, which I'm just going to mention superficially over here, not go into details. It is related to power consumption. Right? In general, in a CMOS circuit, what is the expression that's normally used for the power? CV squared F, right? So usually the way that it is expressed is, there is some alpha, which is a switching activity factor, C, which is the total capacitance that is being switched, the total load capacitance in the circuit. V is the operating voltage, we have V squared, and F is the operating frequency. Okay, so over here, alpha is a switching activity which is essentially architecture or application dependent. What I mean by this is, if I come up with a slightly different way of doing addition, I may be able to reduce the number of times that a particular wire will need to switch. Okay? In general, what happens is that in a large circuit, you can expect that at any given clock cycle, roughly 10 to 20% of the wires are going to switch their values from 0 to 1 or 1 to 0. And a fundamental thing as far as CMOS circuits is concerned is, the predominant consumption of power happens only when there is actually switching activity, when a given wire is switching from 0 to 1 or from 1 to 0. Okay, some current is required in order to charge that output capacitance or discharge it, and that causes a dissipation of power, of energy. Okay, C over here is the load capacitance, which depends on A, the total number of circuit elements that are present, and B, the size of the individual circuit elements themselves. Okay, V is the operating voltage, usually VDD, the supply voltage, and F is the operating frequency. Okay. Now, in the case of a parallel implementation, if you think about it, effectively speaking, what is going to happen is I just, as we saw in this diagram over here, the internal frequency at which the actual the adders and multipliers need to switch or need to operate has become half. Okay, which is good news. It looks as though there is straight away a power reduction. The problem is it's not as simple as that, because the capacitance, because I have doubled the amount of hardware, is actually going to double. Okay, but on the other hand, it turns out that if the voltage, or rather if the frequency decreases, we can use a lower supply voltage as well. Okay, and as a result, it may be possible, it's not always the case, but in general, depending on the particular architecture that you have, it may be possible to reduce the supply voltage. And as a result of reducing that supply voltage, we can basically bring down this overall term, alpha CV squared F. The alpha is dependent on just how the architecture has been put together. We are not doing anything to change that. The capacitance in the case of a parallel implementation has doubled. The operating frequency can be made half of what it was originally. And what that means is, if I want to operate something at a lower frequency, it means I have a longer duration for the time period. It may be possible to reduce my operating supply voltage. Okay, the net result is that I can use this parallel implementation in order to bring down the total power consumed by the circuit. So even though I have more hardware present, right, because I am able to operate at a lower voltage and achieve the same throughput, right, it may be possible for me to reduce the total power consumption of the circuit. Okay, we will look at this in a little bit more detail, usually by, and I'll try to give out some kind of an assignment problem that basically allows you to compute this and estimate it, right? We are not going to go into it in too much detail because it takes away from the core idea of what we are trying to discuss further over here, which is how do I get different implementations and what kind of properties do they have. Okay, all right. So all this was with regard to one particular way by which I can improve the throughput, right? Or alternatively, while keeping the throughput the same, change the structure so that I now use a parallel structure in order to achieve the same throughput while operating at a lower frequency internally. Okay, another way by which I can improve the throughput is by a technique which basically observes that, can I sort of break up the computation into multiple stages, right? So let's go back to the basics. Of the FIR filter structure. what was the problem that we had? This critical path equal to Tm plus 2 times Ta was 4 nanoseconds. Okay, and the question that I'm interested in asking at this point is there any way I can break that? I can reduce that critical path. Okay, and the obvious way by which you can think of reducing the critical path is, after all, what is the definition of critical path? It's the delay from the output of some register until the input of some other register. So if I could have introduced some other registers in the middle of this critical path, let's say for example that I could introduce a register out here, right? Now I would have been able to break the critical path, okay, and I would have got, this is a delay of Tm, this is a delay of 2Ta, okay, max of Tm or 2Ta, in this case both are the same, so it ends up being 2 nanoseconds. Okay, let me rephrase this, that's a good point. I'll just erase this. I'll just call this path delay on the whatever, on this highlighted path. Okay. Right. So the observation is correct. What he said was that there is actually another path which still has the B followed by two adders and so on. I'm just talking about this highlighted path alone. For that, I have managed to break it. Okay. If I could similarly go around finding all the paths that have delay greater than 2 nanoseconds and break them into something where no path is a length greater than 2 nanoseconds, then potentially my critical path of my entire circuit would be 2 nanoseconds rather than the 4 that I originally had. Okay. So question is, how do I go about doing this? Am I allowed to just introduce registers anywhere as I like? Okay. And the answer to that in general is no, you can't just introduce registers anywhere you like, because potentially it is changing the functionality of what you want to do. Okay. One way of looking at it is to say, supposing I had this circuit, right? I have x of n. Supposing this was all that there was to it, right? What is y of n in this case? What is the equation that is being implemented over here? It's basically taking b into x of n, right? This lower path, plus a into x of n minus 1, because there is a delay out there. Okay. Now what happens if I just arbitrarily introduce one register over here alone? This changes the equation to y of n equals b x of n minus 1 plus a x of n minus 1. This is a fundamentally different filter. Right, I have changed the entire notion of what its transfer function looks like, so I cannot do this. Okay, but on the other hand, supposing I had something of this sort, and I introduce one over here and one over here. Right, now what happens? I have essentially got y of n equals b x of n minus 1 plus a x of n minus 2. Okay, the question is this the same as the original filter or not? Or is there anything fundamentally different? Has anything fundamentally changed over here? Can I reasonably claim that this is pretty much the same as the original filter? will it have the same transfer function? Will it have the same behavior? Right? So one way of looking at it to understand it a bit more clearly is to sort of say, can I write the corresponding transfer function, which basically looks something like this in terms of Z transforms, B X of Z plus A Z inverse X of Z, which means that Y of Z equals X of Z into B plus A Z inverse, right? Or alternatively, Y of Z by X of Z, which is the transfer function, equals B plus A Z inverse. In the second case, what I had was Y of Z equals B Z inverse X of Z plus A Z inverse X of Z, which basically gives us that Y of Z by X of Z equals Z inverse into B plus A. And in the third case, what I have is Y of Z equals B Z inverse X of Z plus A Z to the minus 2 X of Z, which gives us Y of Z by X of Z equals Z inverse into B plus A Z inverse. Okay. Now you can sort of see a bit more clearly why the first one and the third one are the same, because just a multiplication by Z inverse is essentially just delaying something in time. Okay. All samples are delayed uniformly in time by one sample period. Okay. They do not otherwise change the nature of the transfer function. In other words, if this was a low pass filter and basically had a cutoff at some particular frequency, the third function, the red transfer function over here, would also have a cutoff at exactly the same frequency. Whereas the second one would essentially have been converted into an all pass, because there is no longer any dependency on Z inverse as far as the function is concerned, right? It just takes the input data, multiplies by a constant B plus A, and delays it by one time unit. Okay, so if there was some averaging or some particular cutoff frequency beyond which it should not be allowing frequencies, that has changed completely as far as the second, the orange one, is concerned. Whereas the first one and the third one have the same transfer function, the difference being that one of them has now got every output sample being delayed by one clock cycle, one sample period. Okay, so in that sense, we say that this original filter and the one where delays or the registers have been introduced on both the legs of the circuit are going to behave exactly the same. Right? This step that we have applied over here is essentially something, the term that is used to refer to it is pipelining. Okay? The idea behind pipelining can be sort of illustrated a bit more easily in the context of just, you know, take out the actual functionality, don't worry about multipliers, adders and so on, and now just look at a chain of different functions that are put together over here, right? Let's call them A, B, C and D, right? And in fact, if you look at the origins of the word pipelining, it's not from the domain of signal processing or even circuit design. It comes way before that. Sort of the first place where it was systematically put to use was in the automobile industry, right? By Henry Ford. Okay, the Ford approach to factory production essentially said that if I have to go through many steps in order to build a car, right? Let's say that one of the steps is to basically take the chassis of the car. The second one is to fix the wheels onto it. The third one is to put the engine in place. The fourth one is to fix the doors, right? So let's say that I have, you know, take the chassis, wheels, engine, doors. Okay, obviously there are more steps involved in building a car, but maybe these are the main four steps that you have over here, right? The normal way by which cars would have been built was, I actually have this being done one after the other, okay? Ford's innovation, so to say, was basically to say that, look, different people can be doing this at different times, right? So I have one part of the factory floor that I'll just mark off as the chassis portion, okay? Normally the way that it would work is the car would be in one particular place, people would come there, they would work on it, and once they are done, they would move away and the next group would come there and start fitting the wheels, the next group would come fix the engine, the next group would come fix the doors and then send the car out. Whereas what he said was, let's change this around, right? Keep the workers stationary, right? And let the job flow, okay? There is another place where wheels are fitted, another place where the engine is fitted, and the final place where the doors are fitted, which means that the car itself basically would go through all of those stages one by one, okay? So the way that it would work is, at time zero, so to say, the first car would appear over here, okay, and it would get the chassis put in place. After that, it moves, okay. So car 1 at time 1 would move on to the next place where it would be getting its wheels fitted, okay? At that time, what would happen? Right? At the second time instant, t equal to 1, the chassis worker is now idle, okay? Let him start working on the second car, okay? At time 3 or t equal to 2, that car which was originally working on the chassis would now move to wheels. The one which has wheels already fitted would move to the engine, okay, and a new car can take its place as far as the chassis is concerned, right? And at t equal to 3, I would have the first one going through to get its doors fitted, the second one would be getting its wheels fitted or engine fitted, the third one would be getting wheels fitted, and the fourth one would just be starting, okay? So this core idea that you keep the workers fixed and let the job flow through was originally applied in the context of the assembly line, so to say, right? That was used for assembling cars. The reason it's called a pipeline is because it sort of resembles the idea of water flowing through a pipe, right? The pipe itself remains stationary, the water or the job is the one that flows through it, okay? Going back to a context of signal processing, right? The idea is once again the same. We have our hardware units that are just going to remain stationary and perform certain work, and the job or the sample that is being computed is going to flow through those hardware units, okay? And going back to the context of something like this FIR filter, what it means is that with this as my original diagram, right, if I wanted to have some kind of a division that allowed me to sort of say, okay, you know, everything to the left is going to work on sample number one and everything to the right is going to work on sample number two, what I actually need to do is to be able to take my entire circuit and divide it cleanly into left and right. Okay? One way of doing it is to say, I will put a division like this. Okay? And say that this is handling one side of the processing, this is handling another. Okay? So these are like the workers on the factory floor. Whatever is to the left of the red line is working on car number 2, whereas whatever is to the right is working on car number 1 or sample number 1. Okay, I can go further and do this again over here and say that I now have 3 divisions. Okay, so now this basically works on sample 3, this works on sample 2, and this works on sample 1. What do I mean by that? It means that I can actually explicitly put registers over here and over here, right? And what I'm going to get finally at the output is, this will correspond to y of n minus 2 because it's been delayed by 2 steps. At any given point in time, when I give the nth sample to the input of the overall system, what I'm going to be getting at the output is something that should have come 2 clock cycles earlier or 2 samples earlier in my original design, but now is basically delayed by 2 samples. Okay? So you can understand what is happening over here. In terms of when is the output coming, it has now been delayed by 2 samples. At a given point in time, when I expected to see y of n, I am going to see only y of n minus 2. That's latency. I can live with latency in general. Right? On the other hand, my clock period itself has been reduced. What has it been reduced to? Now what's the critical path? It has improved, but not as much as I would like, right? Because the critical path now is Tm plus Ta, right? And similarly over here also I have one Tm plus Ta. This has reduced to Tm. But the problem over here is there is at least one path which has Tm plus Ta. And that is going to be the ultimate critical path as far as my overall circuit is concerned. Okay, so yes, this improved matters, but it has not improved things as much as I would like. Part of the reason for that is I chose the wrong lines for doing my pipeline separation. Okay, let's see if I could have done it slightly differently. That's also very easy actually to do. All that it's saying is, why not choose this as my division, right? This whole notion of left and right and what is happening before and after are just some physical constructs that we are using to visualize. All that really matters is logically what is happening before what. And if I use this as my division and put registers over here on these 3 edges, now what does my critical path look like? Over here it's Tm, over here it is Tm, this is Tm, and this last one is 2Ta. Right? So that my critical path becomes max of Tm and 2Ta, which in this case is 2 nanoseconds. Both of them are 2 nanoseconds. Okay, what's the core idea that we applied over here? We needed to delay all the intermediate computations by the same amount so that the output functionality remains unchanged. We saw earlier in the other example of that simplified filter that if I just put one register on one of the paths and not on the other one, I will completely change the transfer function that's being implemented. So I can't do that, right? So this dashed red line that I drew over here, right, is effectively dividing the circuit completely into a before and after segment. Okay, And as long as I do that complete division into a before and after segment, and I'm able to introduce registers on all the edges that go across that, right? It's a safe transformation. I can safely introduce registers over here without changing functionality. And by introducing registers over there, I can hopefully reduce my critical path. And this is a valid pipelining. Okay. This is something called a cut set, right? It's a set of edges that I can identify in the graph where all edges basically go from one side to the other. Okay, I'm not going to say from left to right or from front to back or anything of that sort, because that depends on how I draw it. What is important is logical flow of information. There is a before and an after, and everything flows from the before side to the after side. And as long as I can find that by removing these edges, my graph or my system completely separates out into a before and an after segment, it means that I can introduce registers on all of those edges, exactly the same number of registers, and the only change in functionality will be an overall delay in the final output. There will not be any change in transfer functions other than that. Okay, alright, we'll stop here for now and continue with this core concept of how we do pipelining and how we can extend it beyond feed forward cut sets in the next class. Okay. So by